my name is Roger. I work for Citrix on what's called the platform team. There are a lot of people that work on the open source project. I mainly work on Xen FreeBSD, although I also work on TMO and the Linux stuff on that. And I'm here today to speak about how we plan to move the PCIe emulation inside of Xen. So we will start with the description of the PCIe bus, then we will speak a little bit about the current state of PCIe emulation inside of Xen, how is it done for the different kinds of guests that we support, and finally I will speak a little bit about the work I'm doing in order to move the PCIe emulation playing inside of Xen. So let's start with the basics. PCIe is a bus that was developed by Intel in 1992 in order to attach devices to a computer. It was originally designed for servers, but it was adopted for desktops also quite early. So basically, it's been developed by Intel in 1992, but now the maintainer and the guys that contribute to the stack is a group of several companies called the DCIC, which is formed by more than 800 different companies. And they maintain and expand the PCI specification. When it was first introduced, there were other kinds of bus, like BESA, ACE. There were a lot of different kinds of bus that were used in the computers, and basically PCI is super simple. And it's the main bus used on almost any computer. The main two standards are the first one, which was introduced, which is the PCI local bus, and then PCI Express was introduced in 2004. In between, there were also several other standards like ACD and PCIX, which basically expand the bandwidth of the PCI local bus specification. And it was mainly used by graphics cards because very common to have a PCIX slot and an ACD slot in your model in order to plug the graphics card. And then the rest of them would be PCI slots. So this is how it looks on the monitor. This is the hardware part of it. In this case, the first four are PCI Express slots, and the last one is a conventional PCI slot. You still have desktops, and you open them, you probably find something fairly similar to that thing. Maybe this one has different length because it depends on the kind of slot, but basically you will have something like this, which is where you plug your graphic card, your network card, anything like that, those little classes. And here we have some picture of what you would actually plug into one of those buses. This is a USB 3 PCI Express card that provides for USB 3 ports to plug into one of those PCI slots. So now let's move to what's actually interesting to me, which is not the hardware part of PCI, but I'm more interested in the software part of PCI, which is what I've been working on. So basically, the thing that PCI provides is called the PCI configuration state. That's a standard that's provided by PCI and by the PCI bus. And basically, it defines, well, it provides each device with a certain amount of space. In this case, it depends on the implementation, on the specification, but it's usually, well, it's either 256 bytes or 496 bytes of space for each device that's used to store the configuration of each device and that can be accessed by the OS. This is very interesting because it allows the OS to have a standard way to detect devices. Basically, this is a standard mechanism of detecting devices using the PCI configuration state. Each device inside of this configuration state has a unique identifier, which is formed by the bus, the device, and the function integers. This is usually called a BDF, and it's a unique tuple on the bus. So basically, each different device on the bus has a unique PDF number. So on the configuration space of each device, the first 64 bytes are standard. They are the same across all different kinds of devices. This is called the PCI card, and it's shared between all devices. This allows us to easily identify devices. And the rest of the space is used to store what's called capabilities, which is per device data. It usually contains more, well, let's say, extra functionality of those devices, like whether they can use MSI interrupts, MSIX, whether they have SRIOB, all those kind of things are stored inside of these capability structures. So basically the whole deal about the PCI is that it would make discovering devices much more easier because it was a standard interface for discovering everything. And there's also another, well, usually it depends, but you can brute force scan the whole bus, which means that you test each possible device in the bus and try to figure out where you have a black device or not. This is usually called the brute force scan in the bus. And well, you can do that, but in general, most people rely on, for example, ACPI tables in order to find, in order to figure out which devices are present of the system. And then you can speak to them directly in the PCI bus. With APC6, the way to access the configuration space is either from the I/O space or from the memory space. The I/O space access is called legacy. It's the first one that was introduced, and it's mainly used when you're speaking about the PCI conventional or PCI local bus. And then we also have the way back of accessing the configuration space from memory, which is called enhanced, and it was introduced with the PCI Express. So this is our local PCI access loops, conventional PCI access loops, which is done on the I/O address space. And it's important to notice that for X86, the I/O address space is limited to 64 bytes, so it's impossible to fit the whole configuration space inside of the I/O address space. So basically, what they did on X86 was to use an indirect access to the configuration space. This is done using two different registers, CFA. Is the register that contains the address that you actually want to read. So in this case, for example, we can see that on the register, we would write the bus, the media, plus the register that we want to access. We write this on this register, and then we read the data that we want from the CNC board. This is good, but it's not very optimized, because for each data that you want to access, it requires doing two different instructions, so you have to write to CFA, and then you have to write or read from CFC. This is fine, but it was not really designed with SMD in mind, because every time you access, you need some kind of logging in order to make sure that no other CPU is also trying to access the bus. Because if you have, well, let's imagine that you write that the others are going to access to CFA, and before reading CFC, another CPU writes a different access to CFA, then you will read the wrong data. So basically, you need some kind of external logging on the OS. So in order to solve some of these issues, a new way to access the configuration space was introduced with PCI Express in 2004. This is called Enhanced Configuration Access. And it's basically done by mapping the whole configuration space into memory. Memory on X86 is huge. You have 64 bytes of memory, so you have a lot of space. So you can basically map the whole configuration space into memory. And then basically when you want to access a specific register, you just use the bus, the DDF, plus the register, and you read or write to that address, and that's that as you want. It's a single instruction, and it doesn't require any kind of external logging. And, well, in this case, the register that they have here is just 32 bits long, but the higher part of that access would basically be what's called the base address of the memory configuration space. The firmware can position the access to the configuration space anywhere in memory, so you actually have the start, and then you read starting from that, and then you use the DDF automatically. It's also important to notice that if you see here, the register field is 6 bytes long, well, it's actually 8 bytes long, but on the enhanced configuration space, the register is 12 bits long. That means that you can address 4 kilobytes of data, and using the legacy one, you can only access 256 bytes of data. Oh, and also on the enhanced one, there are some hardware that supports 64 bit access, which means that you can use MOSFET in order to read from memory, but it's not guaranteed, so it's not really used by the operating system, because you don't really know if the hardware supports it. So how does PCI handling currently work inside of Zen? For those familiar with Zen, or those that have used Zen sometimes, basically in Zen we have what's called a privilege domain. We usually call it DOM 0. It's the first guest that's started after launching the hypervisor kernel. So basically you start Zen, which is a kernel itself, it's a microkernel, and then you start a guest. this first guest is a privilege for me. It's called down here, and it has special abilities over the hardware and over Zen itself. It's basically used to control Zen. So in this case, basically, Dom Zero gets full access to the PCI configuration space because it needs to manage all the hardware underneath. So basically, Zen only grabs access to the to CFA and to CFC in order to maintain serialization with accesses from Dom Zero. So basically, Dom Zero has full access to the PCI configuration space in that case. Then when we do pass-through of PCI devices to guests, we have two different kinds of devices. One is called BB, it's the original Zen mode, it's called PARTIS, an abbreviation for file virtualization. It's the first mode that was developed by Zen in order to do virtualization. And in that case, if you want to do pass-through and the guest wants to access the configuration space, we use a specific BB protocol in order to access it. That's called usually PCI front and PCI back. And it's a very specific way of accessing the configuration space. For HVM guest, on the other hand, the guest has the guest needs to have full access to a PCI configuration space. We basically emulate the configuration space for the guest, so it has we believe it's actually accessing a PCI configuration space. This is actually the diagram of how the system looks usually. So we have the control domain, that's the PDM0, which has full access to the hardware, basically, so we can access the PCI configuration space without any limitations, and then I have two different guests, one PDM, one HDM guest. The PDM guest will communicate with PCI back using shared memory link. And basically, this is good that we can see, because we don't need any kind of Zen interaction. The PDM guest and PCI back speak directly. So that means it's faster, it's less overhead because we don't need to tap into Zen. But it's also using a Zen-specific protocol, which means that it says you want to port to Zen and to support PCI faster, you need to implement this new protocol. This is fine, but sometimes you are not even able to modify the guest that you want to run on top of Zen because it's a closed source guest, so you are not even able to implement this PCI protocol. And then for HVM guests, we actually have accesses to CFA, CFC, and to any enhanced configuration space from the guest that's done inside of Zen. So basically, when the guest tries to access one of those regions, we get, we tap into Zen, and we forward this access to the last mode, to PM. PM then performs the emulation for us. If the device is fully emulated, it will be handled completely inside of PM, so PM generates the reply. Gives it to the guest. If we are doing pass-through, on the other hand, sometimes the response is generated by VM, sometimes VM basically reads from the hardware and forwards that to the guest itself. So yeah, this is nice because we don't need to modify the guest, but it's also much more slow. It involves tracking to Zen, and then you need to go to VM, and finally from VM, you know, zero user state and you get the hardware. It works fine, but it's slow. So now we have an ingest type that's called PDA, which is basically an HDM guest from Zen point of view, but it doesn't have almost any emulated devices. So basically, this means that it doesn't have a device model, it doesn't have a PDM instance running for it, because we don't have emulated devices. And also, we used to emulate some platform devices inside of Zen for HDM guest, that's basically the IOAP, the P, the P, the HPED, I think, and maybe something else. All those devices are no longer emulated inside of Zen, so basically the only emulated device provided to a PDHS is the locality. That's the only emulated device. This is nice because it means we can run on this new mode as well as Dom0 and Dom0 because it doesn't provide VM, so we can use it for both Dom0 and Dom0. But at some point we have to ask ourselves how would we like PDH to access configuration space? Would we like to use the PD way? Would we like to use something like the TM way, the HDM way? And we decided that the best thing probably was to do something like this. So basically, in order for PDH to get some kind of native access to the PCI configuration space, we kind of use PM. So we decided to move the PCI emulation layer inside of that. We call this virtual PCI, VPCI in order to aggregate. And basically the idea is that by putting some computational space emulation inside of Zen, we'll be able to handle a pass-through for PBX and HDMS without having to go to VM. For HDM, it doesn't mean that much, because for HDM, you already require VM, so it's not that much of a win. Maybe a little bit, because if VM doesn't have to access a real hardware, you can, let's say, run VM inside of a container or something like that, you can isolate it better, because it doesn't need to run a root anymore, because it doesn't need to access the hardware. And then we place this layer inside of Zen and basically excel doing pass through of PCI devices for both HDMI. The initial implementation is targeted at Mozilla only. We do that basically because on Mozilla the speed is much more relaxed, because Mozilla in theory has access to the both hardware, so we don't have that much speed invested. Part of what's called a trusted base. It's a trusted code that we run. So if you compromise on zero, it's the same as on zero. So basically, in that sense, the stability of the PCI emulation that we have now is not very strong, because it's only been carried for a few . So we looked at a minimal set of features that we need in order to have some kind of working PCI emulation on zero. So basically, we need to have access to the PCI header in order to detect when the guest accesses the header, and then we also need to have accesses to the MSI and the MSIX capabilities in order to forward the output to the . So yeah, the first step in order to implement this inside of Zen was to actually attach to the register that allows access to the PCI configuration state, and then we have to add the tabs to CFA and to CFC in order to detect when the guest is trying to access the configuration state. And then from there we can obtain the VDF and the register that the guest is actually trying to access. We also, of course, need to have access to enhance the configuration of spaces. That's very similar, because it's basically one is an IO port access, the other one is an memory access, but then more or less handles them on each side. So then when we get the VDF, we can actually search for the device inside of Zen, and each device has a linked list of registers that we are loading. I think it's easier to see that with a little diagram. So basically, the thing on the top would represent the access by the guest. You obtain both things, but let's say we operate in the media first, and using the PDF, we search the Zen key that contains all the PCI devices in order to find the PCI device that the guest is trying to access. And when we have that, we get a list of registers emulated from the guest, and we search for the register that the guest is trying to access. See, this is for the zero only, so basically if the register is not on that list, we pass to the access to the hardware. If the register is on that list, we execute the hardware. So this is a PCI header. This is actually what's called a normal PCI header. This is a high key. On Zen, at the moment, we only support pass-through of devices with either type 0 or type 1. Type 0 is called the normal header, type 1 is the least header, and there's also another type of header that's type 2, I think, that's the car bus header. Sadly, I don't have any car bus devices, so I cannot really test that, so I'm not planning to implement that at the moment. And then the fields painted in green are the ones that we actually track when the guest tries to access. So basically we have the command register on the PCI header. We basically need to track that register in order to detect when the guest is trying to enable memory decoding. Memory decoding maps the paths into the guest physical memory address space. The paths is the base address of this device, and this device is basically contain headers of memory used by the device, but that you should use in order to interact with the device. We also track those in order to detect when the guest tries to relocate them inside of memory. And finally, we also track the access to the room base address, which I think is kind of related to the next talk, probably, which is going to be about the room. And then we also track have accesses to the MSI probability structure. This is found after the header. And this structure is used in order to set up interrupts. The guest basically arrives to these fields, and then at some point it will get interrupts injected. The message control is used to signal whether you want to enable or disable an interrupt, MSI interrupts. Then you have the message address. And the message data we are both using in order to detect the CPU and the network that we are coming to. And finally, the mask bits are used in order to mask specific vectors that we want to disable for a certain amount of time. This is also the more complete MSI header because it's using 64-bit addresses and it has a mask bit. There are simple versions of data structure that only contain 32-bit address fields and don't contain the mask bits or the landing bits. And finally, we are also tapping access to the MSIX capabilities. This is fairly similar to the MSIX structure. The only difference is that instead of having global message address and message data, we have one for each vector. Also, another of the differences with the structure is that the part that resides on the configuration space is very small, it's just the top of that flag. That's the part that actually lives in the configuration space. It also contains the message control, which is used to enable or disable MSIX. And then we have two fields that actually point to a memory address inside of the memory space that's outside of the configuration space that contains disable. This is basically done because disable is quite big, so if you place disable inside of the disabled configuration space, it will probably overflow the amount of data to the memory. So yeah, so in order to test this, it's not very easy to test all those kind of things when packages inside of an hypervisor, because every time you make a change, you need to reboot your system, and then you need to find a way to actually test it. So we decided to create what we call a user space test harness. It basically, it's simple, but what we basically do is pick the code from the Zen hypervisor, place it in user space, and compile it together with a small application that contains some tests. Basically, it's very simple, but you end up with a very simple program that you run and it does some kind of, well, it runs some tests. This is fine because it allows us to test the basic functionality, like adding registers, removing registers, all those kind of things can be tested using this test harness. But it doesn't allow you to test specific implementations like MSI emulation or MSI emulation. You can only test that using that harness because you need the actual hardware. You need the actual hardware in order to interact with it. So the current status, at the moment, some parties have already been committed to Zen. Some others have been hacked or been invited, but have not yet been committed to Zen. They can be found, well, the first one is the MIT, the infrastructure on the mailing list. The second one is the random MIT repo that contains the code. And they also have some previous repos in order to test this. The previous repo is not in a shape to be committed after, because it's really one big patch that will help it. That's why I call it a week of work in progress, but it seems to work. I will present that after coming afterwards, but as usual, if you want to test or if you can test, please do so. You can send the test or the bug reports to send the bell, and they will, well, instead of you succeed, but you don't keep an eye there, so I'm sure I will realize that. And then the future work, since this seems to be quite close to being cognitive, we basically start working on implementing SR-IoT emulation for non-zero, so we basically be able to pass to the SR-IoT capability for non-zero. Then I will probably focus on adding the code so it can be used by configurators test, both for PDF and VM. And finally, the idea would be to switch the HVM default pass-through mode from VM to this. So yeah, the plan for making it between the at least I would say a couple of previous problems. So yeah, with that I'm done. If you have any questions. Yeah?
They are in the heading code, so I could imagine that if you have heavy loads in your Zen system, maybe you want to enable for each guest to use a graphic card as a for your compute work, and then you think of sharing.
whether we are planning to share graphics cards with the West, or whether this is especially focused on graphics cards. So what do you say? I'm already done with VM. It's not a limitation of VM. You just need a graphic card that allows some kind of sharing. I think there are commercial products that already have that like Zen server, and what should they have some kind of GPU sharing thing? But I'm not really sure of the status of using Zen actually for that, because basically I don't think we have that code, and I'm not really sure if that requires some kind of black magic in order to work. So I think NVIDIA has covered a little of that, but I have heard of that, so I don't know, but it should work with VM, I think. For this, it's not especially covered at GPU sharing or GPU password. It may make it easier, because we don't have VM in the picture, but the code is already fairly similar.
From the personal view of the performance, how much does it change using this new method of the PCI device? From the performance?
In terms of performance?
Yes.
I haven't benchmarked that yet, but I guess, oh sorry. The question is how much performance difference there is from using VM or using this DPCI client. I haven't benchmarked that yet. I expect there's some performance gain because we have, well, there's less moving around, going into Zen and VM and so on, but I have not actually benchmarked this. I mean, I'm quite sure there's some performance improvement, but this is not done only for performance. It's done because we need it also anyway. So the main focus was to get something working first, and we will benchmark the performance slightly.
Thank you.
Yeah, you can go for that. Yeah, you still need the end for the pure VMware devices. So when you create any, do we still need PMU when we move, when this is finished and we can use the PCI for both HVM and PDH? The reply is yes, we still need PMU because there are devices that are purely emulated inside of PMU. Like the network app is emulated through inside of PMU for an HVM guest. That's not something that we have to move inside of PMU. This PCI emulation layer is only going to be used by pass-through. So when you do pass-through of physical devices to a guest. But the emulated devices that the guest gets will still be emulated in the end.
My question is very similar. Are there any cases that are currently supported with VM using PCI password using VM that are not going to work using emulation?
The question is whether there are cases that will work with VM and won't work with the PCI. I don't think so, because at the end it's just a pass-through layer, so you can place it inside of VM or you can place it inside of Zen. The place is not relevant in that case, so I think as long as we have the right code, it's going to work. If it doesn't work, it's a pass-through.